start now. He has sent a message. You can start.
A very good afternoon to all. Respected Principal Sir, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan, esteemed resource person on the occasion, Dr. Rabindra Kumar Swai, Professor Suryakant Baral, and CMA Shivaprasad Padi, all the respected invited dignitaries, CMA Himoch Mishra, CMA Niranjan Mishra, and CMA Antarjami Acharya, all the faculty members, and most valued participants all across the country. A warm welcome to all of you to the national webinar on goods and service tax moving ahead. Organized jointly by PG Department of Commerce, Dhenkanal Autonomous College, and the Institute of Cost Accountants of India, Bhuvaneswar chapter. As a nation, we have come a long way since the goods and service tax was first implemented on 1st July 2017. This webinar is an attempt to highlight the goods and service tax journey, its present, past, and future since its inception, its challenges and achievements, future prospects, and the recent effort to revive the nation from the economic slump that is caused to the pandemic. So this topic is quite relevant in this present scenario. Without wasting much time, I would like to take this privilege to introduce our principal, sir, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan. He is a professor in English, having more than 30 years of academic and administrative experience. And everything is at its place in his able leadership. He is a man with a human touch. He is a leader with a human touch. I would like to invite our principal, sir, to put his welcome address. Sir, over to you.
Esteemed head of PG Department of Commerce, Dr. Khuntia, distinguished dignitaries and resource persons for today's webinar, Professor Dr. Sukant Kumar Baral from Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Amarkant, Madhya Pradesh. Shivaprasad Padi, CMA, practicing cost accountant. And Professor Dr. Rabindra Kumar Swai from PG Department of Utkala University, Bani Bihar. Esteemed dignitaries and invited guests, Srijukta Mishra, Himoj Mishra, CMA Himoj Mishra, CMA Antarjami Raut, and CMA Niranjana Mishra, faculties of the Department of Commerce, Dhenkanal Auto College, student participants, and my colleagues, and participants, esteemed participants across the nation. Very good afternoon and hearty welcome to you all to this very significant academic event organized by the PG Department of Commerce of our college in association with the Institute of Cost Accountants of India. In fact, it gives me immense pleasure to be a part of this academic enterprise. At the outset, I am specially thankful to Dr. Khuntia and Co. And Co. means the members of our advisory committee for taking a decision, for taking pains, for organizing this particular academic event at a very difficult time. It is a difficult time because COVID-19 is still on, and we are still on our guards, and to add to our words, there are fears and apprehensions of Omicron. Earlier, we had decided to conduct it in offline mode, but because of this corona-related and Omicron-related concerns, we changed our plan and we decided to conduct it in online platform. Anyway, something is always better than nothing, and I'm very sure and very hopeful that something positive and the outcome of this particular academic event will be fantastic, will be beneficial, and it will be useful for all concerned. And I think this webinar will act as a moral booster. It will act as an eye opener for other departments of our college to follow. I request the esteemed HODs of other departments to follow the direction given by the PG Department of Commerce, and I am sure very shortly they will organize more and more seminars and webinars because the conduct of such seminars and webinars will be helpful to our cause, since we are all preparing to face the Nagpur team's visit next year. Anyway, my best wishes are with you, and I am specially grateful to all the dignitaries who have acted as resource persons for today's webinar, and all the invited dignitaries for giving their consent and participation in this webinar. And we are really fortunate and very much privileged to have amidst us a galaxy of intellectuals. And we have got Professor Baral, as Rajani Babu has pointed out, who is from Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Amarkantha of Madhya Pradesh. He is a distinguished scholar, a brilliant teacher, an eminent academic, and one of the valuables in this particular field. And what I have heard, he has done extensive research in economy and commerce. And Mr. Shiva Prasad Pahadi, CMA Shiva Prasad Pahadi, is also an eminent cost accountant. And as a well-known cost accountant, he has also contributed immensely to the growth and enrichment of research in cost accounting. And coming to Professor Rabindra Kumar Sai, I think he does need no introduction to the students of commerce stream of Dhenkanala Auto College and the faculties of Dhenkanala Auto College, because if I am not wrong and if I remember correctly, he had been to our college 2 years back, and I had shared a dais with him in one of the seminars of this PG Department of Commerce. And I have marked Dr. Swain is a prolific scholar. He is equally an, a potential teacher, a very much a student-friendly teacher, and he is noted for his style of teaching, for his clarity of expression, thought, and conceptual clarity. And to add to our pleasure, we have got some invited guests, CMA, Mr. Acharya, and another Professor Niranjan Mishra. They are all quality materials, and they are backed by bag full of experience, and they are also very much researchers, top class researchers, and I am sure their presence and participation, particularly in this webinar, will highlight so many unknown facts about GST, and they will definitely throw fresh insight to the topic, and they will definitely put a sincere try to bring home some unknown areas concerning GST. As regards today's topic for discussion and elaboration, let me say it very candidly that I am an outsider and I do not have much depth, much knowledge, much idea about the chosen topic. But as an outsider, as far as my knowledge is concerned, it is a topic of relevance, or it is a topic of a common interest, and goods and services tax has in fact revolutionized indirect tax in India. It is a single unified tax, indirect tax, levied in products and services. And the salient features of GST is that it lies in the fact that it is added at the value at each sales. And it is a comprehensive indirect tax. It is comprehensive in the sense that it has replaced all types of indirect taxes except few state level taxes. There is in this system, the consumer has to pay the GST charged by the last dealer in the supply chain. There is state GST, there is central GST, and I must say that the introduction of a GST is a very good sign, and it is a historic event for Indian economy. It helps immensely, greatly to the consumers. It checks the evasion of tax and contributes immensely to the growth of economy at large. So I don't want to take much of your valuable time because I am a bit on a foreigner to this particular topic and I don't have much depth. I don't want to highlight your valuable time. I wish this webinar all success and urge all the participants those who have joined this online platform to make it lively, to make it interesting, and make it interactive. And I also put a very sincere request to all our dignified guests and resource persons to interact with the participants very freely and very suggestively, so that all of us, those who have joined this online platform, would be richly benefited. Thank you all, ladies and gentlemen, for bearing with me, for giving me a patient hearing. Thank you. Over to Dr.
Thank you, sir, for your encouraging words. We have two special guests with us. First, I would like to invite Chairman ICAI Bhubaneswar Chapter, CMA Himoj Mishra, to address the gathering. CMA Mishra has been in the managing committee of a Bhubaneswar chapter since 2017-18, served in the capacity of a treasurer, secretary, and vice chairman. He is presently working at TPCODL. Sir, over to you.
Thank you. Jai Jagannath. Very good afternoon to one and all respected patron of the today's national webinar and principal of Dhenkanal Autonomous College, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan sir, convener cum organizing secretary, Dr. Rajanikant Khuntia sir, CMA Niranjan Mishra sir, council member ICAI, chairman of the Committee of Cost and Management for Public and Government Service, chairman of Talcher Angul chapter, CMA Antarjami Acharya sir, resource person on this occasion, Professor Sukant Kumar Barala sir, Indira Gandhi National Tribunal University, Amarkanta, Madhya Pradesh, our own CMA Sivaprasad Padhi sir, practicing cost accountant, SAPSJ Associate, Bhubaneswar, Dr. Rabindra Kumar Swain sir, PG Department of Commerce, Utkal University, and inviting guest. My dear beloved commerce student of Dhenkanal Autonomous College and other colleges also, on behalf of the Institute of Cost Accountants of India, Bhubaneswar chapter, I, CMA Himoj Mishra, chairman, welcome you all to the today's national webinar on the theme, Goods and Services Tax Moving Ahead. At the outset, I convey my hearty thanks and deep gratitude to the principal of the Dhenkanal College and his entire team for organizing such a joint seminar through virtual platform. For information of the students, I would like to introduce in brief about our Nobel Institute and our Bhubaneswar chapter. About Institute, the Institute of Cost Accountant of India is a statutory body established under the Act of Parliament for regulation of the profession of cost and management accountancy in India, having its head office at Kolkata, 4 regional councils, 113 chapters spread all over India, 9 overseas centers, 3 centers of excellence in India. It functions under the direct administration control of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs, Government of India. It is the largest cost and management accounting body in the world and second largest body in Asia. There are more than 80,000 cost and management accountants both in employment and practice, and about 6 lakh students pursuing this course. Career prospects of CMA course can go for a job and shall start your career from managerial level in finance and can end with CFO, CEO, MD, CMD, etc. Can go for practice, can do cost audit, GST audit, internal audit, concurrent audit, and many more, and shall earn till your last breath. Can choose practice by opening own firm in the area of cost audit, internal audit, concurrent audit, stock audit, registered valuer, GST audit, IBC, and many more areas. can be a successful entrepreneur by utilizing the gathered knowledge from the CMA course. After becoming CMA, you can do PhD without postgraduate also. About our Bhubaneswar chapter, ICAI Bhubaneswar chapter is one of the vibrant and best chapter in India and a nodal agency of the Institute for imparting professional education and training to the CMA students at Odisha since the year 1969. For commendable performance in all sphere of activities, ICAI Bhubaneswar chapter already conferred Best Chapter Award 22nd times consecutively in the Eastern region and only the chapter at Pan India who has received Brand Building Award as such. This is the first chapter in Pan India who has imparted coaching through virtual mode during the pandemic. At present, this chapter has around 700 CMA qualified members and more than 2,000 students are being enrolled in CMA course through this chapter each year. In each year, this chapter produces more than 100, In each year, this chapter produces more than 100 qualified cost accountants and more than 200 semi-qualified cost accountants. This chapter is famous for its state-of-the-art facilities, like having own well-furnished infrastructure located at Noyapalli, Bhubaneswar, having own website www.icmaibbsr.in and a mobile app ICMAIBBSR. I would like to invite all the students to have a visit to our website and to download our mobile apps for all the necessary information regarding our chapter and institute. Own computer lab and e-library, around 50 professional guest faculties having excellent exposure both on theory and practical aspects who guide the students for excelling in their examination. In each term of examination, students of this chapter are performing excellent in the term of percentage and number in comparison to all India result. Providing doubt clearing classes as per the requirement of students, staffs, members, and faculties of this chapter are very much cooperative. Many awards and prizes given to the meritorious students in each term to motivate other students for excelling in their examination. Facilities of campus placement, training for qualified and semi-qualified students from time to time. Besides oral coaching and computer training, as per the course curriculum, this chapter regularly conducts employability skill development programs like GD, mock GD, soft skill, computer skill, interview technique, mock interview, industrial tour, student seminar, workshop, orientation program to complete with other professional to grab the placement opportunity. Dear students, I would like to say that clearing the CMA course is not a hard job. It needs effort in a planned manner and practice. You should throw out from your mind such fear. A sincere and average student can clear this course within 2.5 to 3 years, which corporate world need. Course is designed in three layer of system. Those who are pursuing plus two and plus three first year and second year, they may pursue CMA course through foundation and then intermediate and final. Those who are pursuing plus three final year, they may pursue intermediate directly and then final. Present fee structures. The fee is very much affordable to all the students. At present, foundation course fee is rupees 6,000, intermediate fees is rupees 23,000, and final is rupees 25,000. In intermediate, you can also pay in installments, and the said fees is inclusive of your study materials, coaching, and all other training fees. Only you have to pay examination form fill up charges extra. That is for foundation and intermediate, 1200, and for final, it is 1400. Students are advised to drop their further query, if any, in the chat box, which will be addressed during the interactive section. Dear students, some of you might have chosen the commerce stream as option, or some of you have come through compulsion, but both of you have chosen a right stream where you can build an excellent professional career through low investment and high return. To know more detail, may visit our website or you may download our mobile apps. Wish all the students for your bright professional academic career. Good luck. Wishing you all a happy and prosperous New Year 2022. With this, I conclude here and hand over to Rajnikant sir. Thank you all. Jai Jagannath.
Thank you, sir, for your career counseling to our young commerce students. Due to some technical issues, we are unable to reach CMA Antarjami Behera, Antarjami Acharya, sorry. He is the chairman, Talcher Anugul chapter of ICAI. We have to move forward. Now is the time to introduce the theme of the webinar. For that, I would like to invite a person with vast industry as well as academic experience. He is the council member and chairman of a committee on cost management for public and government services, ICAI. It's an honor to invite CMA Niranjan Mishra to introduce the theme of today's webinar. Sir, over to you. Over to Niranjan, sir. Niranjan sir, are you able to hear me?
Yes. Sorry, there is some technical issues for which I could not join. Again, I have switched up and rejoined. Thank you very much, sir. Am I audible, sir? Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are very much
yes, audible. Sir.
Yes, sir.
Good morning. Good afternoon. And I am very much happy that today I am part of this webinar and the subject chosen by the both organizers, Institute of Commerce and Consumption India, Bhavan Chapter and Deccanal Autonomous College, is a vital for today's discussion. I am happy to be part of this webinar. And before coming to the topic, I wish to say I am very much thankful to Dr. Rajnikant Khuntia, Head of PG Department of Commerce, Deccan Autonomous College, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan, Principal, Deccan Autonomous College, CMA Himoj Mishra, Chairman, Bhavan Chapter of Cost Students, CMA Dr. Rabindra Kumar Swain, PG Department of Commerce, Utkal University, CMA SP Padi, GSA Sport, and one of the eminent faculty of our institute, Pan India, Professor Sukant Kumar,
not audible. Niranjan sir, not audible. Sir, I think there is some problem on your part.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Now it is audible.
Yes, audible, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
Now it is Hello. Audible, sir. Now it is audible, sir.
Sir, there are a lot of technologies for which I am unable to join. Okay. So from the institute point of view, when the GST was introduced in the midnight of 30 June 2017, our institute, the first institute which has
some problems
started the GST day. And every year the
voice is breaking.
Hello.
Sir, actually your voice is not audible properly. It is breaking.
And switch up the camera and speak. I think it will be.
Yes, yes. Okay.
Niranjan Mishra sir, switch up your camera and then speak. I think it will work.
Rajni sir,
contact over phone.
Yes sir. Sir, only just a minute. There are some technical glitches on part of Niranjan sir, so we will move forward. Then we will move to our next resource person. He is a person of academic prominence. He has more than 25 years of teaching and research experience. He is a person of several awards for his significant contribution to research field. He holds several prestigious administrative positions as well He is the budget and accounts officer of Utkal University. He is the executive member of All India Accounting Association and general secretary of Bhubaneswar branch. He has delivered more than 50 invited lectures, several publications to his credit, and mentored and produced many MPhil and PhD scholars. It's an honor and privilege to invite Dr. Ravindra Kumar Swain to enlighten the session. He will address on One Nation, One Tax, GST.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Rajani Kumar Khuntia. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are very much audible.
Respected Principal, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan, Dhankanal Autonomous College. Respected Head of the Department of Commerce, Dr. Rajani Khuntia. Respected CMA Himoj Mishra, Chairman ICAI Bhubaneswar Chapter. In the absence here, respected CMA Antarjami Acharya, Chairman Talcher Angul Chapter. Respected CMA Niranjan Mishra, Council Member and Chairman ICAI. Respected resource persons of the webinar, CMA Sivaprasad Padhi, practicing cost accountant. Respected Professor Sukant Kumar Baral, Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Amarkantak, Madhya Pradesh. Respected teachers of Commerce Department of Dhankanath College. Respected teachers of other departments of the college, respected teachers who have joined from other colleges, and most importantly, our beloved students of the college and outside the college. So it is my honor and privilege to be part of this program. As a principal was telling, I had visited to his college, of course, 2 years back when everything was normal. I had visited to the college. So we are missing that physical appearance in different places because of COVID-19. My dear students, I'm going to share my slides. Rajani, is it visible, my slides?
Yes, sir. It is clearly visible, sir.
Yeah. So today I will focus on the topic itself, that is, all of you know, goods and service tax. So I have divided my topics into primarily three parts. Some conceptual parts are there, and the significance of GST from Indian perspective and global perspective, some empirical study I'll just share with all of you, and also I'll show you how GST is calculated by taking simple examples. As my dear students, particularly, as you know, tax is an integral part of our components of GDP, that is Indian economy. Our Prime Minister Narendra Modi is dreaming that Indian economy should be $5 trillion. But by 2025 or 2030 or 2050, now we are yet to reach that $3 trillion. If you want to achieve that target, one of the components that will contribute to have that achievement, that is our economy growth. Direct tax and indirect tax. If you see the statistics, it contributes around 12 to 15% maximum of GDP. If you see the developed countries like USA, France, China, or you may say Japan, you'll find their contribution to GDP of tax is 30+%. So we are not even 50% of their category. So major source of revenues for governments for expenditure is tax. In this context, our indirect taxes now have been replaced by the new concept, that is goods and service tax. So instead of paying various taxes over goods and services at central level, at state level, we now are paying since 2017 one tax, that is GST. Of course, there are some commodities on which GST is not calculated or charged. You know that petroleum products, alcoholic products, and some other products, we'll discuss that. So in this scenario, why I have just kept this particular picture in this slide, I think the picture tells the big man is pushing out a healthy what animal out of that. So that means GST was in our third since 2000, but it could not be implemented because of some reasons. Now we have GST in reality after 2017. If you see, my dear students, our tax is broadly classified. I think all of you know, one is direct tax, another is indirect tax. So when you say direct tax, it is the tax simply paid by the taxpayer directly. Tax is imposed on the person who earns income, that is income tax, is a direct tax. Shifting of tax is not allowed in income tax or direct tax. But direct tax is progressive in nature. What is the meaning of that progressive in nature? Generally, if you have ability to pay more, if you have more income, you'll pay more tax, because our tax slabs are like that. 5%, 10%, 15%, 20%, 25, 30, like this. If you earn more and more, rate of tax goes on increasing. So direct tax is progressive in nature. But if you see the indirect tax, it is the tax which is generally paid by the person who consumes the goods and services at the end of the chain. But it may be collected at a different point of time by the supplier, by the wholesaler, by the retailer. Finally, consumer pays the tax. So shifting of tax is there in indirect tax. That indirect tax is regressive. Means as a consumer, whether you are rich consumer or poor consumer, if you consume a product or goods or services, you have to pay regardless of the ability of consumer to pay tax or not. So that's why if you see our contribution of tax to GDP, contribution of direct tax is more than that of indirect tax. Maybe direct tax base is wider, broader than the indirect tax base. So that tax base is narrow in indirect tax because we had many types of indirect taxes like excise duty, sales tax, VAT, so many. We'll discuss that. So in that case, in order to make the tax system very simple and smooth, and tax compliance is easier. Now, tax base has been broadened. Thereby, we'll be able to collect more indirect taxes, that is what you today call GST, goods and service taxes. So this is the fundamental of that tax. Tax is a compulsory practice of collecting money from the people on certain basis. It may be on income, it may be on providing services or supplying goods. So it is not compulsorily charged by government, rather it is legalized under different law and act. If you see our pre-GST indirect tax structure, my dear students, look at this slide. You see, this was before GST Act 2017 was implemented in India. Excise duty was paid on manufacturing of goods. Service tax was paid on provision of providing services. Sales tax or value-added tax was provided if it is within the state. If it is between states, that is, central tax was collected. Custom duty on import and export. And local charges were there also. Octroi duty, entry fee. All these taxes were there before GST was implemented. So according to the constitutional framework, if you see the union list, these are the taxes were collected under central government: income tax, custom duty, excise duty, corporation tax, service tax, central sales tax, so many. If you similarly, state list is there, state was collecting taxes, tax on land building, excise duty on alcoholic liquor, etc., entry tax, sales tax, toll, luxury. Concurrent, simultaneously, union and state were also collecting tax on certain items, stamp duties, like this. So all these taxes are subsumed, are included, except you, under GST. So if you see the shortcomings of our indirect tax structure, why GST is there? If you see the multiple tax rates are there, yes, different tax are there, tax, different rates are there. Low tax base, because in case of indirect taxes, the amount of sales, amount of supply of goods was less. Now it is more because it has been broadened according to the regulatory system, you know. Levy of excise duty on manufacturing. Yes, earlier it was excise duty was paid at the point of manufacturing, but now it is at the point of supply, at the point of consumption, destination. That's why GST is called our destination-based tax or supply of goods-based tax. If you see multiple rates were there, as some complexities when somebody wants to pay tax, whether it be a direct tax or indirect tax, we face a lot of difficulties of understanding different provisions of different laws with respect to payment of a particular tax. But we need not follow now different provisions, we will follow GST provisions. Similarly, high cost, if you are paying excise duty, you have to comply that. If you are paying sales tax, you have to comply that. So cost of compliance and administration was more. So many difficulties, or you may say limitations, you may say problems everybody encountered while paying. Even income tax, this says even our commerce teachers, even if they are acquainted with the income tax calculation, they also go and take the help of a tax consultant while filing the return of their income. So This is because of complexity involved in tax filing. So compliance, that the procedure of compliance is difficult or was very simple to understand. So that is why our government is trying to bring reform in all regulatory framework, whether you talk of accounting standard, if you say now IFRS or EDS converged IFRS we are following, because earlier accounting standard now is simplified under EDS or IFRS. If you go to another act, that is Companies Act 1956 and Companies Act 2013. 1956 was very descriptive and it is very rigid. Now it is replaced by Companies Act 2013, which is more of rule-based, it's principle-based. So government is trying to bring reforms in the regulatory framework in order to simply invite the businessmen across the globe to India. So ease of doing business is possible or will become easier in India if you bring reforms. So GST is one of the steps where a lot of reforms have been made in our indirect tax. So then what is this goods and service tax? I told you earlier, it is based on consumption of goods and services. If you consume goods, you have to pay goods tax. If you consume services, you have to pay service tax. Of course, some exemptions are there. But on which tax is paid? The value of goods you consume, you pay tax over that. That's why value addition, VAT concept is there in our GST. But cascading effect, I'll tell you, tax on tax. If you pay tax on a particular value of goods, that should not be again taxed once it moves from one place to another. That indirect tax concept had included. Now it has been neutralized by input cash credit. We'll discuss that. Our GST is dual GST. What is the meaning of that? This GST is collected by center as well as the state simultaneously. So if it is collected by the center, it is GST. I think I'll tell you later something about that. If you collected by the state, it is GST. This is intrastate supply of goods. If goods and services are supplied within a state, that is intrastate, where we pay both tax, central government service tax, SGST and the CGST. If you transfer supply goods and services between two states or between union territories or one state to one union territories, then integrated GST comes into the picture. But that integrated GST, again, a portion is kept by central government and another portion is given to the state government. We'll discuss that later. If you see this picture, GST, one is intra within the state. If you say inter, that is between the states. But if it is within the state, if you purchase any goods and services, you pay, let's say GST is 12%. So 12% is divided into two parts equally. One is the CGST, another is the SGST. If it's 12%, 6% goes to CGST, 6% goes to SGST. If it is between two states or union territories, then this is case of interstate tax. So that case we pay IGST, integrated goods and service tax. So IGST again, a portion is kept by central government and a portion of that is remitted by central government to state exchequer. And if you want to know what are the taxes included in GST, these are the taxes, you know, these are under state, these are under center, state VAT, entertainment, luxury tax, taxes and lottery, betting tax, central excise duty, everything except you will discuss again. These are the things which have been subsumed. Subsumed means included in GST. Instead of collecting tax, different tax at different point of time, earlier before 2013, now we are collecting only SGST or CGST or IGST. So all these taxes are included in our goods and service taxes. One another concept that is very important to know is taxable event. What is this taxable event? If I go to direct tax, if I earn income, then earning of income is a taxable event on which I have to pay tax. If you are earning income, that earning of income is a taxable event. Earlier, if you are manufacturing goods, you were paying excise duty. So manufacturing of goods is taxable event. So under GST, what is taxable event? It is supply of goods. Supply of goods is taxable event, supply of service. So it, what is that supply of service, supply of goods? It may be what a business, it may be profession, it may be vocation, it may be commerce, trade. It is defined clearly in GST Act. And it is course of or furtherance of business. If it is directly related, it is also taken as supply of goods. Even if it is indirectly related, then it is also considered as supply of goods and services. Of course, when you supply goods and services with consideration, I think you know consideration means something in return. If I supply goods for nothing, then I am gifting. I am giving gift to somebody. So without consideration, certain cases, it is also coming under GST. If you are giving gift to your relatives, then it comes under GST. If you giving gift to your unrelated parties, it is not coming under GST. Because if you have more income, the possibility is that you may transfer part of your property to another party. So that is why supply is the taxable event. The sound is coming from...
Please mute yourself.
The sound is coming.
Mm-hmm.
Hello, please mute yourself if you... So, taxable event, my dear students, when GST is to be charged? First is whether there is supply of goods and services. If there is supply of goods and service, then we call it taxable event under GST. You have to pay tax. So, whether you have to pay tax or that, or not, then whether it is exempted from tax. So event is arises, something out of which tax arises. If I am giving an example, if you produce goods, you have to pay excise duty. So producing goods is a taxable event. Similarly, if you supply goods, it is a taxable event. Negative list of supply. Even if you supply goods, it is not coming under taxable event. Like what I do here in this webinar is I'm giving you service. Service of sharing my knowledge with all of you. So this is not coming under the supply. It is exempted under GST, educational institution. Services provided by teachers to students. So similarly, tribunal, when some advocacy work or some legal activities are done, they are also excluded from this supply chain. If you see this again, level of GST, nature of supply, I have already explained this one. If it is an intrastate, you see, my dear students, value of goods and services is taken at the here. Interested. So if it GST is 12%, that is divided into portion, equal portion, that is 50% goes to CGST, another 50% goes to SGST. So if you see here, similarly in interstate, IGST is calculated directly, but here in the intra, within state. So two taxes, one, if tax rate is 18%, 9% goes to CGST, 9% SGST. If it is IGST, 28% is calculated direct 28%. But a sum total of 28%, what goes to CGST and another proportional part goes to our state government. Another is who pays goods and service taxes, GST. So generally, it depends on turnover of a person.
Please mute yourself.
So registration is required if your turnover is more than the threshold limits, 40 lakhs and 20 lakhs and 20 lakhs and 10 lakhs, 40 lakhs for all states, 20 lakhs for northeastern and hill states. But in case of services, 20 and 10 lakhs. If your turnover exceeds that threshold limit, then you are under registration. And somewhere threshold limit is not considered if you are selling interstate or non-resident persons. But this is not applicable to. Yes, sound is coming, disturbing. Hello. Rajni, you can ask the host to mute everybody except the person who is present.
Sir, I have already muted that person.
But how he is or she is able to. Okay, this is absolutely the technology that happens. Okay,
yes, fine. Sir. Okay. There is some.
Okay. Again, our time of supply is very important. I told you, supply is very important. Time of supply. At the moment you supply goods, that time invoice you may give before supply of goods. Once goods are supplied, or once your payment is received. So, if you do one of these three earlier, then somebody is again drawing something on screen. Rajni?
Yes, sir.
Somebody is drawing on the screen. It looks, yeah.
Biswal, sir, are you able to hear me?
Annotation, one is there, annotation.
Change in setting in annotation.
Just off the annotation, yes, so that others cannot use it.
Sir, host can do that. Biswal, sir, yes, please. Yes.
Okay, sir, I'm taking care.
Yes. Somebody has already written something here.
Okay, taking care, sir.
Okay, fine. So time of supply is very important because invoice date is one. When goods are supplied, maybe invoice may be sent along with that or before that also. Completion date, once supply is completed, then payment may be made after that or before that, advance payment may be made. So any one of them which comes earlier is taken as time of supply. That determines the liability of GST, when GST is to be paid within the next 20th day of the month. So that is why in case of service, we take invoice date and date of receipt. And constitutional amendment, I think all of you know, GST is regulated by the GST Act 2017. We have GST Act for the state, for the center, for the union territory. And there are some commodities which are not included. I am just telling alcoholic products, electricity, petroleum products. These are the commodities that are not included in GST. If you want to know why these are not included, all other commodities are included. My answer will be very simple. If you go and ask any state government, They collect maximum revenues from these petroleum products, alcoholic products, electricity products. Around, I was going through internet, around 2 to 3 lakh crores per annum. Every state government is collecting. It's a major source of revenue. This is what independent or this is independence state government gets to collect revenues. But other GST may not give that amount of revenues to the government. That's why in another 5 to 10 years, I do not think that this will come under GST, because this is just like white elephant for state governments. So state government has the now opportunity of generating revenues, a maximum revenues, of course, from these products. If you the computation part, I want to explain this cascading effect to the students. If you see the earlier regime and GST regime, somebody has written over it, so it is not clearly visible. Manufacturer supplied 1,000 goods of rupees 1,000, and earlier, let's say, excise duty is 10% tax. 10% of 1,000 is 1,100. Now, after manufacturing goods, if it is transferred to another person with labeling and repackaging, value addition is 300. Now it is 1,100 plus 300. Now it is 1,400. And tax is 10%, 10% of 1,400, that is 140. What happens here? We pay tax on value addition, 10% of 330 plus tax of 100. Plus tax of 1,000. So tax on tax is there or was there in earlier season, that is indirect tax. Tax of 10% of 1,000, 100, 10% of 100, 10, 10% 330, 30 plus 10 plus 100, that is 140. If you see here, my dear students, 1,000, 10% of 1,000, that is 100. Value addition is 300. Now you are paying 10% of 330, 100 plus 30, 130. So 130 here you are putting 140, extra 10 is tax on tax. That is called cascading effect. Now it is removed by what? That input tax credit. If you see this input tax credit, if you are X of Odisha supplying to Y of Odisha, that is interstate, and its value is 1 lakh rupees, and GST is 12%. In case of intra, we divide that in 2 parts. One is GST, another is GST. 6% of 1 lakh, that is 6,000. 6% of 1 lakh, that is 6,000. 6,000 is deposited with state central government by X, and 6,000 is deposited by X to the state government. Thereby, value charged by X to Y is 1,12,000. But there is no question of input tax credit here. If you go to another slide, you can see here, the same person, Y, which had purchased that one from X, taxable, and he added 30% value towards that. So cost taxable value of that goods will be towards 1 lakh. Now he added, let's say, 30% value, that is coming 1,30,000. But it is again, you see, that is intrastate. Z is from Odisha. So that's 12% will be divided 6% and 6%. So 6% of 1,30,000. Earlier, 6% of 1 lakh was given. But here he is to pay 6% of 130, that is 7,800. 7,800. Out of 7,800, already 6,000 was paid by X to the government. So government has to collect now 1,800 and 1,800. That is what done here. Central government and here is state government. We have paid 7,800 on output. But already input, we have already paid 6,000. That is called tax credit, input tax credit. 6,000 you have already paid. Already paid by whom? X. Already paid by X to central government, X to state government. So what the remaining amount Y has to pay? 1,800 to central government and 1,800 to state government. And this 6,000 is called input tax credit because you will not pay same tax or the tax on same value twice. That is why input tax credit is allowed. So input tax credit negates the cascading effect, that tax on tax. So thereby cost to consumer after tax is very less. If you compare this slide, if I have done here, earlier indirect tax cost was 2,244. Now it is 1,980. So you see there is a difference of 264. It's not small amount for poor consumers. So I'll go to another slides and finish within 5 to 10 minutes or 5 minutes. So if you to see the India tax revenue collected, 17-18 particularly our GST has gone up, you see 12% of GDP. Earlier the percentage of contribution of tax to GDP was very less, you see the bar diagram. So if you see it is increasing, so it is because of tax base, it is because of simplification of tax structure. So definitely our tax revenues or revenues from GST and direct tax is increasing. But in 2021, because of COVID-19, the volume of the GST has gone down. But if everything comes normal in future, again, we'll start collecting more. So tax contributes to the GDP. But if you see the global perspective, you see France is contributing more than 45%. And all other countries, you see, it is European countries particularly, 50%. That's why they're developed countries. They're collecting not higher tax they're collecting, rather their tax base is very, very wide. So we are collecting tax from very few consumers. Other consumers are not, tax evasion is there, you may say. Some people are consumed, they're not paying tax. Now GST is a technologically driven system where you cannot escape, thereby you will pay tax. So if you compare India with developed countries, you see their economy is more than Indian economy. In the sense, they collect more percentage of GDP from tax, but India is very, very tax rate of GDP is very less. So that is why GST has been implemented, but over 2-3 years, GST is 4 years old. If you see 17 to 21, it's a 4 years old. It is in infant stage. If you nothing in the world will give you instant result over 1 or 2 years. If you do continue to do works over years, at the end of long period, effect will be reflected. So that is the also case with the GST. I have done an empirical study. I have collected 20 developed countries data, 30 developing countries data to know the impact of GST on their economy. What I found is, if you see here, the red line, GST contributes positively to the GDP. If your GST increases, your GDP also increases. That was also expected at the time of implementation of GDP. 2 to 2.5% of GDP will increase because of implementation of GST, but it is not possible within a short period of time.
Odisha state
Imagine. Yeah, over the time, then GST has contributed a lot to developed and the developing economy. So if you see the developed and developing economy, GST has contributed significantly and positively. So my findings is that results suggest GST has positive impact on economic development of the country. Sorry, somebody again disturbed.
Please mute yourself. Please.
Yes. GST, it is not what I am telling. This is what my study on the basis of data collected from RBI site and World Bank site. the developed countries and developing countries economy is affected positively by GST. That is why their contribution to GST is 40 to 50%. European countries, India's contribution is maximum 12 to 15%. If you want to be an economy of $5 trillion over another 10, 20 years, our GST base has to be broadened, and that is possible with implementation of GST. So this will boost the economic growth of the country as evident from the study. So question answer will be done at the end. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share with all of you. Whatever I had in mind, I shared. So GST is the biggest indirect tax reform in India. No doubt, nobody has any doubt with this concept. That is why GST is one tax, one nation. That will help India to achieve the $5 trillion economy if we follow it in principle. Again, I'm repeating, in principle. If everything we follow, definitely India is going to develop in the future. Thank you very much for your opportunity giving to me. Rajni.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. The most difficult part on part of a teacher is how to simplify the complex things. You have your own style of teaching, as we know. Thank you, sir, for your valuable input and insight. Next, we have another resource person. He is an eminent academician having a distinguished professional career, has drawn his MCOM as well as MBA in finance area, and currently practicing as a cost accountant and based at Bhubaneswar, Odisha. He is the partner of MS, SAP, SC and Associate Cost Accountants. He is the former Dean of IMIS Bhubaneswar. He is also an associate member of Indian Institute of Insurance Surveyors and Loss Assessors. He is a visiting faculty at various reputed B schools, XIMBA, IMIS, Xavier University, Ravenshaw University, Keat University, and a few others also. He has taken sessions at XLRI Jamshedpur on different subjects. He has a handle, audit, consultancy, advisory services in relation to taxation and other areas to Ministry of Railways, NALCO, NTPC, GAIL, Balmer Lorry and Company, RITES, OPCJ, OCPL, OHPC, OTPCL, Kulan, TPCODL, and many others. It's a privilege having such a resource person with us. I would like to invite CMS Shivaprasad Padhi sir to address the gathering. The topic of discussion is GST as a game changer for government, taxpayer, and the economy. Sir, over to you.
Thank you very much, Professor and Dr. Rajinikanth Khuntia, sir. First of all, hearty congratulations to you again on being conferred with a PhD degree. I hope I'm audible, Khuntia, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir. Audible.
So, in fact, it's a great privilege for me to share some of my learnings with the members of faculty of Deccan College and also the students and other members participating. My deep regards to our principal, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan. My regards to CMA Niranjan Misra, sir, a luminous personality of our profession and our Central Council member, chairman of our chapter, Mr. Himoj Mishra, very eminent Dr. Ravindra Kumar Swahi, sir, of PG Department of Commerce, Bani Vihar. Sukant Kumar Baral, sir, namaskar. We are friends in Facebook, but we get very few opportunity to interact. Hope you remember. Almost 1.5 decade back, we had last met in person at Allahabad Bank with the late Mr. Dr. S.C. Bihari. That time, probably you were at Bhubaneswar. So, So it's a great opportunity for all of us to unlearn, relearn, and learn again the subject GST. To be very frank, I have been tracking GST from the very development, from the very inception. We were taking part in the discussion made by various forums set up by the government and industry bodies. After GST was implemented, I was lucky enough to get assignments to work for various corporates and Ministry of Railway. Even today, we work for many eminent business houses for GST consulting and audit, and still we are learning. I will never say that I know many things or everything. It is impossible, but still we make mistakes. Many companies, many consultants, many taxpayers have made mistakes. Some of them are still making mistakes. And here we have an opportunity to learn. First of all, it's almost 4:18. My schedule was supposed to start at 4:20. So in that way, probably I'm lucky that there is no time overrun. And I can take maybe around 40 minutes time, whatever has been allotted to me for an interaction. But I must thank Dr. Ravindra Kumar Swami sir, who has made things very simple. He, in fact, gave a very simple introduction to the subject, including the genesis, the architecture, the framework on which the GST, the biggest ever tax reforms is based upon. Sir has also explained it very nicely regarding the types of taxes and how it's applicable. And some of the legal provisions also silently, sir, has discussed, even though without referring to, you know, the legal provision section, subsection provision, etc. So now I have, in fact, just a minute, let me share the resource file which I have prepared for you. Yeah, hope it is visible to you, right? So my focus is... my focus area will be to discuss issues what makes goods and services tax a game changer. I remember when GST was about to be introduced way back in 2016-17, there was a much talked about term, that taxplosion. Some of the experts and the policymakers, they were expecting that there will be taxplosion. That means the collection of GST would perhaps surpass all the estimation of the government of late. After a very challenging time of Corona, COVID-19, we have been witnessing of late that for the past few months, the revenue collection is beating all its records, and continuously the collection is increasing month by month. Now, coming to the architecture of GST, please appreciate, India as a huge country with so many states and union territories, and with having 130 crore population, which we have now, around 6 lakh, more than 6 lakh villages, and around more than 6 crore MSMEs, and 130 crore consumers of all ages, we were not so tech savvy. We were not so tax compliant. The entire system was fractured, was based on, you know, different state and central taxes. Taxpayers were taking undue advantage. The traders, the business community, they took utmost advantage of tax evasion. I'm telling it with sincerity. Of course, I'm with responsibility. Of course, I'm giving this statement with a exception that there were a very few evaders. It's not that each and every taxpayer or each and every businessman was evading tax, but there were very few players or businessmen who were evading tax. There was a time when three sets or four sets of books of accounts were maintained, one for income tax purpose, one for company account purpose, one for tax purpose, and one for publication purpose for outsiders, etc. The accounts were not integrated, and the number of law that we were complying were many. 17 taxes got subsumed in GST, more than 23 different cess, state and center got subsumed in GST. companies who were operating pan India were following different state taxes and central taxes. So he sir was mentioning about excise duties, service tax, CST, central sales tax, VAT, luxury tax, then entry tax, octroi, entertainment tax. So many different central and state taxes were really bothering the taxpayers, the honest taxpayers, who were very much a part of the mainstream and contributing immensely to the growth of the economy. But the few who were actually creating all difficulty, all problem to the government exchequer, to the lawmakers and the department have been really caught or have been really, you know, identified of late one by one in due course of time. That is why the tax evasion has been reduced gradually, for which tax collection is going up. No doubt changes in the provisions made by the government from time to time is another factor, another reason for which tax collection is going up. But the framework, the architecture which government has thought about, which is completely based on a system of computer and internet or connectivity, use of machines has got its own advantages, where the errors are identified very easily. Information system it becomes very effective. Monitoring, administering becomes very effective and very faster. And evasion becomes extremely difficult in due course of time. And with simplification of the system, elimination of so many taxes and duties, now the taxpayer is focusing on only one tax and provision of only one act and the notifications and other rules, which has made actually business easier. There are many issues which go in contradiction to my statement, which we'll discuss in due course of time. But the biggest advantage, the game changer that GST has brought in, is the use of technology. And we all know that when we use technology, not only our record maintenance, tax payment makes easier, but also the reconciliation, also the audit, also someone can ensure that accuracy is maintained, timeliness is possible, compliance is possible 24/7. Sitting at any part of the world, someone can file return, someone can pay tax, someone can comply to the notices, someone can reply to the notices, someone can raise questions, someone can contact the department either over helpline or by sending a mail or by raising a query, by a ticket. So now GST has broadened the area actually. Earlier it was focused, for example, excise duty was focused for manufacturing only, and services, which was also a major indirect tax, was focused. State sales tax and VAT, central sales tax, was also very focused. Now the GST in one tax, now the a trader or a manufacturer or a service provider is complying many taxes at a time, which has broadened the scope for a taxpayer as far as limiting or reducing the compliance burden. So also for the government and for the department for implementation and administration of taxes is concerned. Now the transparency is at its best now, of course, with the 4 years of passing of GST enactment. What we have realized now is miles to go. Lot many difficulties were faced almost by every taxpayer at the beginning. Hardly you find any one taxpayer in this country who did not face any difficulty during the time of implementation. Anyhow, when a new house is built, a new house is constructed, there will be problems. There will be leakages. There will be some problem in some of the PH or bathroom sanitary fittings. There may be some damage where someone has to reconstruct. So settling down takes its own time and pace. So GST also took its own time and pace to settle down to a great extent. Lot of changes were made, which was a hindrance. More than 1,000 notifications have been made so far in a period of 4 years, little more than 4 years. And government, which acts on a concept of cooperative federalism, both, you know, the effort of the central government and the state government equally is there in case of, you know, implementation of GST and enactment of this act, where in the GST Council, all the state governments are, the finance minister of all the state governments are members. The union finance minister is the chairman, and also the union government has only 1/3 of voting power, and all the states combinedly have got 2/3 voting power. That is why the earlier framework, like center is Bada Bhai and state is Chota Bhai, is no more existing in case of GST. It is a kind of collective and combined decision which union and centers states are taking today because of this cooperative federalism. That is one of the best framework and the support base on which the entire GST system is based on, because we are as a federal country, federation of states, federal state, we cannot, center and state cannot work in isolation. They have to combine hands, and at least in the area of taxation, even if they have difference in opinion, still now on almost every issue in the council, they stood combined and they took collective decisions, because union government unilaterally cannot take any decision today. On even if all the states combined together, they cannot take any decision unilaterally. So the consensus of center and at least 20 states is required to take any decisions in case there is a voting. That is why the states and the center have realized that we have to live with cooperation, not with competition. Earlier, there was competition between center and state. Center was telling, I will tax on services following the union list as per list one of the constitution. And states were saying, okay, we will also tax on services. And there were few goods and services which were both treated as goods as well as services. Both center and state were taxing concurrently. It was a very difficult position for the taxpayers. That is why following the best practices of GST, which was implemented by more than 150 countries by that time, and a very powerful tool of indirect taxation system worldwide, was brought into our country and was successfully implemented. Now, the technology-driven framework is both a challenge as well as an opportunity. It was a very much difficult state of affairs for almost all taxpayers at the beginning. But slowly, with the simplification of the return filing system, simplification of the payment system, changes and modifications, amendments in some of the very important and crucial provisions, repeated training, FAQs, documents like frequently asked questions, videos, interactions, etc., could make the taxpayers learn that the technology, in fact, is a friend, not an enemy, not actually a hindrance or a bottleneck for any taxation system. Country like ours, now we have 130 lakh taxpayers. Before GST, we had only 65 lakh taxpayers. Around 65 lakh, it just got doubled. Around 65 lakh taxpayers were paid after GST. Friends, I would like to show you something. And this is actually relevant for the students to have a view. I have referred the Ministry of Finance website, and here is the BE of 21-22 budget estimate. We'll get the RE when budget is presented in the month of February, but I hope this is visible to you. And you can see, friends, I have also made a highlight, corporation tax and tax on income in 2021, 11.08 lakh crore is the expected revenue from direct taxes. I repeat, 11.08 lakh crore is the expected revenue collection from direct taxes, which is company taxes paid by the companies, corporate taxation, and individuals or tax on individual income, other taxes. So direct tax collection is expected to be 11.08 lakh crore in 21-22 as per budget estimate BE. Look at the indirect tax. Customs duty still prevails. The basic customs duty still prevails. Part of it has been subsumed in GST, but basic customs duty still prevails. But excise duty also still prevails. Professor Swani was referring to 5 petroleum products and alcohol for human consumption. which is still there in the state list and union list. It is not there in the GST fold as of now. Still, collection from excise duty is still there. And very surprisingly, if you look at these two, excise duty for 2021, which was COVID hit, and 21-22, which is also COVID hit, when you compare it with the pre-COVID period, you find that there is almost a collection of more than 1 lakh crore because the petrol rate was increased even during COVID time, for which state government and central government could actually compensate their revenue loss when the lockdown and shutdown, the tax collection reduced due to lockdown and shutdown, and a lot of benefits and privileges were also extended by the central government in form of GST. For example, deferment of due date for payment, reduction in interest rate, etc. But you look at here, what I want to highlight to bring to your notice is union excise duty was collected more in 2021. This is RE. RE means final. 2021 3.61 lakh in comparison to 2.67 lakh, close to 95,000 crores was collected more in central excise. And believe me, this came only from two products, petroleum, all these five petroleum products, and alcohol for human consumption. Okay. Now, similarly, they're expecting a hike, a similar collection of excise duty in 2021. But I want to highlight that only CGST and IGST collection, if you look at CGST, IGST and CESS collection, including the union territory tax, GST collection by center itself was 12.67 lakh crore. So direct tax, look, SGST is not there. State tax is not there because it is a union budget. Okay. Now, of course, state tax combinedly, all the states would also be 6.3 lakhs. But now what I want to highlight is collection of indirect tax is more than direct tax. And this year, take it for granted, the actual collection would be 20 to 25% more than the projected tax revenue for indirect taxes. Right? So gone are those days when direct tax collection was more than indirect taxes. You can see in the previous year also, it was 9 lakh was the direct tax collection. And indirect tax, if I include customs, excise duty and central GST, it is 15 lakh. So indirect tax collection has surpassed the direct tax collection. Okay. And obviously, I'm sure the way the mechanism has started giving result, the way government is, the department is eyeing on the tax evaders. Every day we hear that somebody is arrested or some money has been recovered or a nexus was unearthed or some evasion was found and attachment of property. These days, what do you find? Every day notices are issued, and it is a system driven issue of notice. Whenever the system finds any deviation, because the technology has its own beauty and advantage. Even if somebody does mistakes inadvertently, system automatically catches that and automatically notice comes to me by email, the taxpayer, and the taxpayer has to comply. This makes the job of the department, the government, easier. At the same time, the taxpayer who are honest, they are not bothered, they are not quite worried about this approach, but those who made errors and those who evaded tax knowingly or unknowingly, pays late tax or deviated from the payment than the due date, or took excess advantage in form of availing more input tax credit, or did not pay any interest or late fee, etc. Late fee, of course, is a system driven figure which someone has to pay in case delayed filing of return. But now the tax evaders and those who were taking undue advantage of the leniency of the system, even during the initial 1 to 2, 3, 4 years, department took a very softer stand. They did not question, they did not ask many questions, except the very few, big taxpayers. For small and marginal taxpayers, they in fact, the environment was very conducive. But now they have started become a bit aggressive. Every day I listen from my clients and from clients of my friends that they have got the notice, they have got a demand, there is attachment of bank account, there is attachment of stock, and there is arrest where the evasion is used, and it has many different impacts. Now people have started realizing that I have to pay tax even if I don't, you know, distribute dividend or I don't, you know, do any other commitment, but discharge of tax liability has now become priority for many taxpayers. But at the same time, the implementation of GST has given a huge advantage to taxpayers who operate in a large scale, who are present in many different states, who are doing with or dealing with many goods and services. They are at an advantageous position in comparison to the previous or pre-GST environment or situation. Now, I have already discussed few issues, so I will, mention there. I will not touch upon each and every point. Now, the beauty of this taxation system is small taxpayers have been given benefit. Dr. Ravindra Kumar Swami was mentioning about the threshold limit, 40 lakhs for goods, 20 lakhs for services, 10 lakhs for small tax. Can I request those who have... Okay. To please mute. Okay. Now, the threshold limit, which is considered to be 40 lakhs and 20 lakhs for services, is really game changer. Many small taxpayers, I'll give you a data. We have around... So I'm removing those who are making some noise. Yeah.
Sir, already removed.
Yeah. So now the small taxpayers or the small traders, we discussed that we have got around more than 6 crore MSMEs. Okay. And these MSMEs are the backbone of the economy. That is why the act gives them a cushion. Till you do not attain a turnover of 20 lakhs for as a service provider or 40 lakhs as a goods trader or a manufacturer, you need not register. Right? But registration is optional. Many traders, many service providers still register to avail input tax credit, which is the beauty of this taxation system. Sir was actually giving us a kind of a calculation system where sir was saying that the pre-GST taxes was less and the pre-GST taxes were more and GST tax liability is less in GST regime. But sir, unfortunately, if you really look at it, the benefit of the seamless availment of input tax credit has not actually come to the taxpayers. Maybe the inflation has eaten away that benefit of price revision or price reduction, which taxpayers should have reduced. But yes, in long run, there will not be price rise. Had GST not been there, inflation would have been much more than what we have today. If we are having a 4-5% inflation for the past few years, it has not gone up much. Of course, some economists say unless there is inflation, the economy will not grow. There has to be inflation. But the inflation would have been much more had GST not been introduced. But otherwise, the benefit of seamless input tax credit, which is available in the GST system, actually is the real game changer. Because someone who is an honest taxpayer can save money if registered and if complying to the law as per requirement and availing all the input tax credit which he or she is eligible to. Of course, the system, the taxation, the provision has become so stringent now that that if I buy from someone and someone has not filed tax his tax return or not discharged his tax liability, I'll not be eligible to take input tax credit. That is ought to be, because government needs revenue at the end. Let us think for a moment about the things which government is doing for you and me and for the whole country. And for that, me as an individual or someone, some taxpayer has also a liability to discharge very honestly. And that we have to do. That is why the ultimate tax burden comes to the end consumer. That is why from this 1st January, again, there is a change in the rule. I will not go to the technicality of it, but the department, the government is also, you know, tightening the screw of those who were taking undue advantage of the system. Okay. Now, the technology has, you know, given an opportunity for use of data mining, artificial intelligence. There is robo audit, there is something called machine learning, and the department has their own business intelligence and fraud analytics which they are using, and days are not far away when today we get a challan in our mobile phone, automatically it comes when we when we violate a traffic rule at some places, not at all places. I don't know whether you have experienced or not. I have experienced, many of us might have experienced, not wearing a helmet or talking in mobile phone, driving at a faster pace, etc. The interceptor automatically catches, the camera automatically catches the violators, and automatically within 2, 3, 4, 5 minutes, a message comes to our mobile phone and we have to pay, you know, we are paying that fine online. Days are not far away when GST, the use of technology will be so extensive that it will compel everyone to be just and fair and sincere and punctual, whether it is in written filing, whether it is the payment of tax, whether it is replying to the notice of the department, whether it is audit, or whether it is any compliance. So this needs a lot of understanding of the provisions. This was a much debatable point that a mere trader, small trader located at a two-tier city, a semi-urban or a rural area, not having an internet connection, not having a computer, can he file a system? Can he comply to the law of the land? Many supporting facilities government has created. There is a provision of GST service provider. Even you, some of you pursuing graduation or who has completed graduation can become a GST service provider. You can provide this facility of GST return filing, tax payment, amendments, registration, complying to the notice, etc. by sitting at your village or at your house. So now there are many GST providers, service providers who have come up. For corporate players, there is no problem. They have professionals, they have SAP, they have ERP, they have specific software for GST compliance, etc. But even for small taxpayers, just by sending an SMS, even a return can be filed today. And just by giving few data, few figures, someone can file return. Of course, what GST has compelled to us is online maintenance of accounts. There was a time before GST when audited accounts, before audit only, accounts were prepared by many. Books of records were not maintained. Purchase register, sales register, production register, stock register was not maintained. But now GST has made it compulsory indirectly for every taxpayer to maintain it. Unless tax is integrated or the accounts is integrated with the taxation, there is every possibility that one would pay either paying higher tax or less tax or not complying to the provisions as per requirement. That is why even a small trader today maintain a purchase register, maybe manually, maintain a sales register, maybe manually, raise an invoice, because when the value of the goods is more than 50,000, there is a requirement of e-way bill. Look, this mechanism has been developed in such a way that the scope for evasion or non-compliance will be unearthed automatically. For example, let's say there is a system of TDS, like income tax, tax deduction at source. There is a tax deduction at source today also by, in the GST law. Of course, at present, is it applicable only for services supplied to government and PSUs? But gradually, they will increase the ambit. Now, if let's say GST has been deducted, GST TDS has been deducted from someone's payment and someone is not filing return, The machine will automatically highlight who are those people from whom GST has TDS has been deducted but not filed return. If GST TDS turnover is shown as at a higher value and return shows a lesser value, automatically it will be highlighted. The income tax return form 26AS has been synchronized with GST return. We are able to see the summary of the GST turnover in our form 26AS today. The PAN, the Aadhaar, the bank account has been all linked to GST system now. Now, those are gone are the days when someone was, you know, doing some transaction and it was not reported. Now, with annual information system and in the taxpayers information system, every transaction virtually will be mapped. Hardly, I think, a decade down the line, you will find that any transaction that you and me make will be under the scanner of the tax authorities. They'll be able to understand what you have bought, where you have spent, where you have paid cash, what capital asset you have created, where you are paying GST, where you are availing GST. Everything will be in the fingertip. Think that it is not possible. Today it seems difficult, but maybe 10 years down the line, maybe again, if we meet, we will have a different environment where tax compliance will be at its optimum efficiency level because of the technology, because of the stringent measures that the government has brought in form of the GST law. The law provides many different facilities and relaxations also. For example, there is a system of opting either to become a regular taxpayer or a composite taxpayer. Okay, a trader who is dealing whose turnover is not exceeding 1.5 crores can opt for a simpler tax system called regular taxpayer. He can opt to become composite taxpayer instead of regular taxpayer. So by becoming a composite taxpayer, he need not comply all the applicable provisions of GST. Very few provisions are applicable to him. Again, the rate of tax that at which he pays tax is only 1%. And the beauty of this entire GST system, which Swami sir was also highlighting, same law which is applicable for center CGST, the state law is nothing but a mirror image of the central law. So center and state, they are in fact working in coordination, and the law is also almost same. You can say a replica or a mirror image, except very few deviations. And the administration also, the taxpayers have been divided between the center and the states very logically. Those taxpayers whose turnover is below 1.5 crore, 90% of them have been now administered by the state government authority because they have more manpower, more resources. Central government, that is CBIC, deals with around 10% of the such taxpayers because they have less number of people, less resources, and they also look after central excise and service tax even today. It's not service tax, but customs duty even today. So that is why technology has given another opportunity or benefit to the taxpayers. So returns auto-populate. For example, if I file my sales return, my tax liability return will auto-populate. We call them 1 and 3B. Let's say I file 1, 3B will auto-populate. Okay. Or if I have filed all 1 and 3B, my annual return will auto-populate. Okay. And the challan, let's say I want to pay tax by paying in cash. So the challan will auto-populate, pulling the tax liability data from the 3B. And after settlement of ITC also, the challan will be auto-populated. So the technology has a beauty which can only be enjoyed when someone is connected to it. Actually, to a great extent, the taxpayers have acquainted, accustomed themselves with the system of tax compliance, but still very few of them have still difficulties in compliance. And now the major challenge, of course, is those taxpayers who could not comply in the past are getting notice, getting demands with penalty, with the interest, which is definitely a very worrisome factor for Okay. So now the difficulty which has been faced by some of them, they have to overcome it. Because, you know, there is a saying, for every action, there is equal and opposite reaction. Honest taxpayers, I will not say they are they did not face difficulty or they will not face difficulty. But fact remains, if a taxpayer is honest, if there is any inadvertent mistake done, of course, that can be rectified, that can be corrected by paying the additional tax with interest or whatsoever. But fact is, no one can escape from any deviations made, or even no one can actually really think of any deviations which someone can, you know, dare to make in future, right? Okay. I was referring to this, that a taxpayer has to be punctual and particular. I myself made a lot of mistakes in the initial days. A slight error can, you know, lead to a big mistake in case of GST. For example, Swain sir was referring about intrastate supply and interstate supply. Let's say instead of intrastate supply, someone by mistake, paid interstate supply. Because there is a rule called place of supply rule. You have to determine whether it is intrastate supply or interstate supply. Now, if there is a wrong classification of place of supply, then someone will have to again discharge a correct tax liability, and maybe the excess tax paid can be adjusted or refund can be sought. But fortunately, there is no interest part on that, but definitely it will be an embarrassment. Okay. And I was talking about this quarterly return and monthly payment is another very nice system which they introduced in the GST regime, by which a taxpayer whose turnover is not exceeding 5 crore annually can actually opt to pay taxes every month, but filing of return can be on quarterly basis. This has got its own advantages and disadvantages. I will not debate on that, but definitely something which is helping many, taxpayers. Now, explained about this. Why?
Please
mute yourself. Please mute yourself.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Continue, sir. Now, petroleum products, Swain sir has elaborated it actually. Almost 40% of the state tax revenue of almost all states comes
from
petroleum products and alcohol for human consumption. It varies from state to state.
He asked about Jiban Mati. Ask about alcohol.
Okay. So now that is why, even though there is a provision that these 5 petroleum products may come into the GST net, but the GST council will decide. Many of the states, they are not giving their consent. There is a reason to support that, of course. But what will happen even if it is brought into the net of the GST? Look, the maximum GST rate can be 40%. Now we have major rates 5%. 12%, 18% and 28%. This can become maximum, this can go up to 40%. Now, average tax on petroleum products is around 65%. There is a study, there are different studies, of course, from somewhere I had come to know that all state and central taxes combined together is 65%. It varies from state to state. Because there is excise duty, there is a VAT, CST also. So that is why the tax petroleum, let's say 5%. Now the maximum tax rate is 40%. So what? Government has another provision of implementing cess. Now cess is collected to compensate the states apprehend if we remove many students in the participant, then the number of participants is getting reduced. But I think that is really a nuisance. I'm sorry to use this word, but that is a real disturbance which is not expected. You all are quite responsible, and we all are, you know, expected to behave responsibly. Okay. Now, government can implement cess, and cess, as you know, on same goods, on demerit goods, on luxury goods, cess has been levied on some goods and services. Cess has been levied. For petroleum also government can levy cess. So they, if they want to collect tax, nothing can restrict them. So let us not think it in our mind that if petroleum product comes within the ambit of GST, it will be cheaper. Never, it will never be cheaper. Because government can implement, can levy cess on petroleum products to take it up to that level. Right? So it cannot be cheaper. And ITC will be blocked. There are many items on which ITC is not eligible. Not many, of course. If you look at section 17, subsection 5, it talks about
block. Cha.
So on second, yeah, what was it? Yeah. So on same goods, like tobacco, the highest cess is as high as 290%. Cigarette, for example, you know, the maybe 60 to 70% of the tax of a cigarette is constitutes taxation only. Okay, 290% cess. That means if tax rate is 28%, 28 into 2.9 is the cess.
ये सेटा ता ना सेना थे देखे ले ताको पूरा ताको रिमूव कर देले सेटा ता ना देखो उचे कौन गुटे केरे देखो उचे
ओके सो
किमिते देखो उचे से
फाइन आई थिंक
न्यूसेंस कर चुके
हैं आई हैव ऑलमोस्ट कवर्ड मेनी पॉइंट्स व्हिच आई हैड थॉट ऑफ it's close to 5 p.m. I'm eager, and we all are eager to listen. Baral sir, Sukam, Professor Sukam Kumar, Baral sir, and there is a question answer session where we can.
How many?
So thank you very much, all the organizers, for this opportunity, and thanks to all the participants for a patient listening. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Instead of some glitches, you have summarized all the points. You have covered all the areas. Now it's the time to invite our next resource person. He is an eminent academician, an accredited management professor, and he has been closely associated with several Indian and foreign universities. To his name has more than 20 awards at national and international level. He has been the chief editor of many reputed journals and the author of more than 15 books. It's an honor and a pleasure to invite Professor Sukant Kumar Baral, professor from Department of Commerce, Indira Gandhi National Tribal University, Amarkantak. I am sure I have left many more his academic SARS topic is understanding GST and its impact on business outcome. Sir, over to you.
Very good evening. I will not take much time. Esteemed principal of Dhankanal Autonomous College, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan. My fellow speakers, Professor Ravindra Kumar Misra, and we listened to another of my friend, my younger brother, Shiva Prasad Padhiji. And we listen to Hemraj Misraji, who is the CMA and chairman of ICAI, who has given his insight to this. And both of the speakers, they have told, they have explained in a very splendid manner, in a very technically, they have established the subject. Pleasure to come up the topic with the understanding of GST and its impact on business outcomes. Before entering into the subject, I would like to go with some statistical data so that we will find at the end of the day that why GST was very much important for India, why government struggled a lot and convinced a lot and passed the bill for the overall growth of business in India. Looking into GDP, India is being considered as third in size in terms of power, purchasing power parity. It is around $8.6 trillion. And the rate of growth is 7.6%. It is the fastest growing economy in the world. And if it will go to the foreign reserves, it is around 366.7 billion US dollar. And if it will look into the road network in the world, India stands in the second position. It is around 33 lakh kilometers. And if it will take the statistics of internet users, it comes around 462 million, which is second largest in the world. And if at all we'll take the population, age group between 15 to 64 is 767 million. And if at all we'll take the statistics of urban population, it is around 377 million. 30 people move every minute to urban area. And if at all we'll take the example of railway network, Indian railway network is the second largest network, which is 23 million people travel every day. With this background, I will be trying to tell you again, what are the unparalleled opportunity and possibilities are available in India so that GST will become a kind of boost, will give the boost to the business. India is being considered economically, in fact, will be taking is huge consumer market as per the BCG recent report, and they have cited that 3.6 trillion US dollar will be, consumer market would be by 2025. And if it will again go to the GDP in terms of purchasing power parity, it will be 20 trillion US dollar expected by 2025. And if at all socially we'll go, the youngest nation, average age is 29 years. And for your kind information, for next 15 to 20 years, India is going to supply 25% of human capital to the entire world. And looking into this skill workforce, if with the new education policy, it has been aimed that the enrollment ratio will be enhanced from 25% to 50%, more than 50%. And if it is going to be achieved by 2030, then the literacy rate of India will be 99%. That means it will create a scope to produce more and more skilled workforce. And in terms of skilled workforce in the world, South Korea is standing in number one. And our position is very less. That is why there is an opportunity if at all the literacy rate could be enhanced. And if at all politically, we'll see there are so many outdated laws repealed to reduce red tape, 1,000 plus laws. And with this, I will be trying to tell you that the growth, what exactly we are taking growth and how GST would be helping for booming the business, general business, general economy of the country. And here we have taken the statistics, and India remains an oasis of growth among slowing global outlook. And India is projected to be the fastest growing major economy and in comparison to China, and it is expected very soon. And the trend is expected to continue at least from 2017 to 2022, and maybe deferred another 1 year or 1.5 year because of this COVID-19. And looking into that, the income level is expected to be triple of the Indian people by 2025. And the urban market shall account for 2/3 of the consumption growth over the coming decades. And working population is increased by 33% to reach 1.14 billion by 2025. That is why India, as a young nation with average median age, shall be 37.3 years by 2050. So we have got a very bright future. I told 15 years, the future, 15 years, we are going to supply 25% of workforce from India, but it will continue till 2050 and 60. It will be continuing like this. And up to 2050-60, if being the youngest young country in the world, we have got a several or huge opportunity to understand what is GST. With this drop-off, new process has already been implemented, ease of doing business, startup and other things. And this is the only government who has given a very, very attractive package, 20 lakh crores for developing business during COVID-19. Stimulus package. And we have got GST, demonetization, and many other sectors, if at all new sectors will be taking the major FDI reforms and inflows have been taken place. And we have new projects, new mindset, India having a new mindset, which is made in India, which is known as Digital India. Another term is Skill India. And if at all we will go for infrastructure, in terms of infrastructure, key infrastructure and urbanization is the priority of this government. And new innovation and R&D, if at all we will be taking, India is moving, is marching towards
Design and Innovation, Startup India, Intellectual Property Rights. And for that, we have got a new mindset. And with this backdrop, I'll be telling you, if at all, we'll be very quickly, I'll be summarizing. I'll not take much time. The impact of GST in macroeconomic indicators is likely to be very positive in the medium term. And you see, apart from inflation and other thing, inflation would be reduced as the cascading. This cascading tax on tax, that will help a lot to reduce inflation. And GST, you know very well, a certain boost by 2%. By 2% only, and others by 7.5%. All charges. And with this, it has been seen that indirect tax revenue has been increased by 12% at rupees 10.75 lakh crore in financial 2020-21, and which exceeds revised estimates. And with this backdrop, I will not go details with this because it is available everywhere. So my point is that goods and sales service tax is the biggest indirect tax reform in India. And GST is a single tax on supply of goods and services. And it has taken away, or GST has subsumed central excise law, service tax law, VAT, entry tax, octroi. Earlier, there are so many things. So in this way, I have taken one example for the students, those want to calculate how GST will be calculated. Before GST regime, for example, a consultant offering a service for say 50,000 and charge a service tax of 15%. That means it comes 7,500. You can say for 20,000 and paying 5% VAT. That means it comes 1,000 again. He had to pay 7,500 output service tax without getting any deduction of 1,000 VAT already paid on stationery. Then how it will be calculated? It will be calculated like this. The total outflow here will be 8,500, and under GST, if at all will be calculated, this will be 50,000 total service rendered, 50,000, and 18% is 9,000, less GST, office supplies, 20,000, here we have taken 5% is 1,000, and GST to pay, net GST to pay, is 8,000. So this is the basic difference between old and new. And apart from that, there are some beauties, some importance of a GST. Because you see, we need a law or procedures or rate of tax, what the products are being sold and purchased. So we need a harmonization on that. So GST brings harmonization on that. And it improves overall investment climatic condition, the climate in the country, which is a very conducive and naturally gives benefit to the states as well as to the center. And it improves the compliance environment and the awareness that all returns to be filed online. And you see, earlier there was a chance of a manipulation of many things, but it is difficult nowadays. And apart from that, very quickly I am going, that calibrated fiscal approach adopted by India through this, and it is as per this survey of economic survey highlights that fiscal policy response of a government has been a combination of a demand and supply side policies. And Atmanirbhar Bharat is a self-reliant approach of our nation. So self-reliant approach of the nation is possible if at all, as per Professor Swami, nation one tax system. It is highly possible. And apart from that, I'll be telling you that very quickly I am leaving all those things. These are the products are not included in GST. Is five petroleum products: petrol, diesel, petroleum crude, aviation fuel, natural gas, alcohol for human consumption, and power sector. These are not coming under GST. And here it is a simple comparison of current tax scenario under current and GST regime. So this is an example for the students, those love to learn taxing system and other things. They are having their subject as a subject, so they must be knowing. Manufacturing cost 4 lakh, here is 4 lakh. And excise here earlier, it was 20%, 12%, and infrastructure shesh is 1%, is 52%. Here, central GST is 36%, 9%. And here, VAT is 12.5%. Here, state GST is 9%, it comes 36,000. So here the value comes 5,08,500. Here the value comes 4,72,000. So the dealer cost here will be 4,52,000. And here the dealer cost will be 4 lakh rupees. And margin, the same margin, if at all we are going to keep, is 50,000 and 50,000. And here the selling price would be 5,02,000, here 4,50,000. So there was a VAT of 12.5%, because every step it is being required as per the old rule. And it is 62,750. Here we have to add, as per central GST and state GST is 9%. It comes 5,31,000, where the earlier calculation was saying 5,64,750 rupees. So this is the best part of GST. This is the best part of GST. And very quickly, I shall tell you the business outcomes of GST in logistic, because India is a vast country. I have shown you the logistic, the road, the train, and other things I have shown you. So we need transportation facilities, and nowadays blockchain technology and others, they have emerged to make a very faster delivery and giving information accurately. So in this backdrop, we have that well-organized and mature logistics industry has a potential leapfrog the Make in India initiative of the government as desired by the government. And e-commerce sector is growing like unique. And the tax collection source mechanism currently very much encouraging, very much conducive for e-commerce. If you will go to the pharma business, then certainly the whole goes to pharma and healthcare industries. They are the major sector to enjoy the benefit of GST. And telecom industry and your this textile, all are being benefited, including real estate and agriculture sector, FMCG. So these are the sectors, and most important and very interesting freelancers I have taken here. Freelancing in India is still a budding industry, and the rules and regulation for this digital industry are still up in the air. But with GST, it has become much easier for freelancers to file their taxes on them, as they can easily do it online. They are taxed as service provider, and new tax structure has brought about consistency and accountability in this sector. And we are very much happy to know that all sector, including automobile and the startup, are doing well with this GST. And with this, I don't want to, anybody has raised a hand. Anything else would you like to ask, so that I'll become happy to answer question. Over to Dr. Khuntia. Dr. Khunti.
Thank you very much, sir, for enlightening the session with your valuable words. Now it's the time to question answer session, interactive session. So we have sent a question link in advance. There are some questions for our resource persons. Here, first question from Krishna Chandra Rahul, student of Dhenkanal Autonomous College, to Padhi sir. Why is the GST Council not considering 5 petroleum products under ambit of GST law? What probable situation may force the council to take such step?
We have already discussed about it. In my opinion, even if it is brought into the ambit of GST, government has power to raise the tax rate up to 40% for petroleum products in particular. And over and above the 40% rate, there is a possibility of levying cess, as we find cess on motor cars and many other seen goods and luxury goods. So just by bringing it into the ambit of GST, petrol will not become cheaper. ITC, there is every possibility that ITC will be blocked. Please appreciate major collection from taxation, both by center and state today, comes from these petroleum products. Okay, apart from alcohol for human consumption, which is a state subject, that is why it will never be brought into the ambit of GST. But these 5 petroleum products, no state is willing to allow it to be brought into the GST net, because they will lose their monopoly of charging any rate of tax, state tax, on petroleum products whenever they want to, make a matching of their revenue shortfall. That is why we should forget that it should be brought into GST concept, and even if it is brought into GST concept, it will not be cheaper. Maybe when the collection of GST would be close to maybe 150 lakh crore or maybe 1.5 lakh crore or 1.6 lakh crore, at that point of time there would be a possibility of matching this revenue shortfall in form of allowing ITC. Maybe government may include some of the petroleum products, if not all five at a time. For example, there was a discussion going on to include natural gas first. I'm a consultant to both GAIL Gas and GAIL India, and what I find there is the CST and state VAT and excise are applicable to gas, where both state and center are getting their revenue. So maybe natural gas is which is hitting the mass like petroleum would probably be included under GST first, if at all all the states agree. All the states means at least 20 states has to agree along with the center. Center in open, they have said that we are ready to bring petroleum products into the GST net, but majority of the states turned it down.
Thank you, sir. Sir, another question is, why is SGST levied on all interstate supplies in Delhi, even though it's not a state? Asking by a student, Krishna Chandra Rahul.
What is the question, sir?
Sir, why is SGST levied on all interstate supplies in Delhi, even though it's not a state?
No, when we talk about state, it is a union territory and state tax. Apart from the central tax, union territories have their share of union territory tax, UT tax, what we call as, and states have their state tax. Delhi is a state actually. Delhi is a not a union territory. Delhi is a state, and it has got its own state GST law. That is why there will be Delhi state GST whenever there is any intrastate supply in Delhi. Right, you have to go to the place of supply rule to find out where actually intrastate and interstate sale happens. For example, if let's say I am registered in Odisha, I'm running my business and a registered taxpayer in Odisha. If I go to Delhi and if I stay in a hotel located at Delhi, then the will always levy Delhi state GST and CGST. And as I am not registered in Delhi, I will not be able to take this input tax credit. That is one of the limitation of the act till now. But otherwise, for intrastate, even in Delhi, there will be Delhi state GST and CGST.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Sir, another question. What are the negative impact of GST on the manufacturer? Question is asked by Samarjit Samal.
Let us modify the question a bit. Instead of asking the question, what are the negative impact of GST upon manufacturer, let us make the question like, what are the challenges that a manufacturer face in case of GST? Look, a manufacturer, as you have asked only difficulties or challenges, I will discuss only difficulties. The list of advantages are many. The list of benefits, the list of advantages that a manufacturer gets out of GST are many. But if you come look at the disadvantages, then compliance to the best extent possible in respect of outward supply and inward supply is definitely a challenging task for any manufacturer. Then the loss that occurs due to theft, due to any destruction or damage, input tax credit is not allowed to a manufacturer. And even today, some ITC is not available when there is a free sample or there is a gift of any item.
But Nikhil, you can't do it anymore. You can't do it.
In case there is a process loss or production loss, definitely the ITC can be availed. But when there is a free gift, free sample, when there is a theft or loss due by destruction or writing off from the books of accounts, it is not eligible. Again, a manufacturer doesn't get all the ITC because there are blocked ITC. Of course, they are applicable to traders also, to service providers also. But the blocked ITC, like maybe works contract or maybe rent a cab or maybe some expenditure relating to their employees and laborers, they are restricted. That is why a manufacturer, in fact, gets many advantages. The only disadvantage or challenge that you can say is he has to be extremely tax compliant by complying to the law in respect to outward supply, inward supply, classification of proper classification, correct classification of goods, charging the correct rate of tax, availing the correct input tax credit, wherever reversal of input tax credit is required as per the provisions of the law, making appropriate reversal of the credit. If the turnover is exceeding 2 crores, filing the annual return. If the turnover is exceeding 5 crores, filing a reconciliation statement. These are the few challenges which a taxpayer in general, that to a manufacturer, usually face. Another thing is, if a manufacturer is operating in different states, let's say they have plant in 2 different states, then they need 2 registration. Even though we call it to be a tax which center and state operate simultaneously, but registration is required for each state. Wherever a taxpayer is present in a particular state and doing any supply, taxable supply, or receiving any inward supply, he needs to be registered in that particular location, particularly if a manufacturer wants to avail ITC. So number of registration is more. Of course, in case of excise duty also, it was state-wise registration. Not state-wise registration, but one registration. Service tax also one registration, but VAT was state-wise registration. In that comparison, the compliance is not more for a manufacturer. Apart from this, I don't find any major challenge or major problem for a manufacturer per se, because on capital goods, ITC is eligible. On input goods, ITC is eligible. On services, ITC is eligible, except the block credit. So there are many advantages, very few disadvantages. And the major one is compliance.
Thank you, sir. For more questions, we will chat you or mail you. Thank you, sir, for your valuable insight to the interactive session. Finally, we come to the verge of this national webinar. First of all, I beg sorry for the any type of disturbances that is happening in this webinar. We will take care this in our next attempt. We will go for the webinar version definitely. On behalf of PG Department of Commerce, on behalf of Office of the Principal, I would like to extend a very hearty vote of thanks to all the resource person to grace the occasion and took out your valuable time. I would like to thank Professor Suryakanta Baral for the valuable insight to the webinar. My deep sense of gratitude to Dr. Ravindra Kumar Swai for igniting the gathering. I am also very grateful to CMS Shiva Prasad Pade for injecting deep insight to the webinar. Thank you, sir, for your valuable time. I am also very thankful to CMA Himoj Mishra, CMA Antarjami Acharya, and CMA Niranjan Mishra for sparing your valuable time and inspire us. My special thanks goes to Mr. Hemant Kumar Biswal, ICAI Bhuvaneswar chapter, for coordinating the event. He is the man behind the scene. My heartfelt gratitude to our principal, sir, Professor Ranjit Kumar Pradhan, for his constant guidance and encouragement. Last but not the least, my sincere gratitude to all the delegates, faculty members, students, participants all across the country. All the participants will get e-certificate within 7 days in their registered mail ID. Again, thank you all for joining us. Looking forward to meet you once again in the future. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Sir, namaskar. Baral sir, namaskar.
Namaskar. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank
sir,
you.
Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar.
Sir.
Namaskar, Rajinikanth. Thank you sir. Very much. Thank you very much. Well done. Mm-hmm.